So thank you very much for the for the introduction and for the possibility to let me present my recent work. So as you say, yeah, I'm a computational physicist interested in Monte Carlo and quantum Monte Carlo since more than 10 years. But some years ago, I started also my interest on quantum computing. And so quantum computing is a highly polarizing topic. So there are a priori optimist people and a priori pessimist people, right? And for me, even classical computing is hard because now I would like to act on these windows. Okay, I will just leave all your name here. So people that say that there are going to be fundamental limitation to the building of this machine, and other that will say that it's going to revolutionize our life. So instead, I'm in the middle, as many of you, I hope, and which I just believe that this is going to be just a technical challenge, and eventually quantum computer will be built. The thing is that is important to start already today understanding conceptually which algorithm and application can benefit from this quantum computer, which will have anyway some real practical limitation, right? So not everybody will enjoy quantum speed up. So the outline is, first I will introduce in a most simpler way quantum computing, at least in the conceptual level, and then I will introduce the application and the algorithms, which is this new algorithm to speed up Metropolis sampling on classical classical energy landscape. So I promise that I will only use 3 slides for quantum computing, so let's try it. So a qubit is formally a 2-level quantum system. So you can see that a spin 1/2 particle, right? Defined on this basis state, the 0 and the 1, but I could have used spin up and spin down, right? So I can generalize this concept with n qubits, and now the Hilbert space become 2 to the power n dimensional, and a generic wave function is written in the basis of this string state, like 0, 0, 0, 1, and so forth, right? So here we already see something interesting, because if classically I want to specify the state of this of that can be encoded in a quantum computer, then I have to specify this 2 to the power n complex coefficient, right? This number such that already if I have a qubit of register size of 50, I will need to have 2 to the power 50 complex number, which equal to 16 petabytes. And quickly I run out of memory, right? So a quantum computer is very efficient in, as the name may suggest, to store in and compress wave function, right? And here you can also see why quantum chemists are interested in this, because if you see these strings, for instance, as a occupation number of molecular orbitals, so you see this as a collection of Fock state, you can store a very, very long full configuration interaction wave function using only n particle, right? N bits of qubits of memory. However, being able to store a wave function doesn't mean that you can automatically do something useful, right? With this stuff. So in order to go to the next level, you only also need to show that manipulating this wave function is also useful. So a normal classical conventional computer, for instance, suppose that you have 4 bits in your variable, right, in your memory, then you have 16 entries, right? And then suppose that we want to see what is the effect of a function over these 16 entries, there is no way but to repeat the calculation f of x on each of these entries and see the output. So the bad thing is that I have to repeat sequentially, or say, I can even parallelize, but I have to make all these 2 to the power n function call to each of the input. So this is bad. The good thing is that I can still save the output and reuse the output as many times as I want, as long as I can store it in a memory, right? In a quantum computer, the philosophy is much different. So in a quantum computer, I can even prepare all these input in superposition, and now there is a normalization that I took off just for aesthetic purposes. So I can prepare my superposition of inputs, in this case 16 in superposition, And then I can claim that there must be an operator, which must be unitary because quantum mechanics is a unitary theory, that is able to compute in superposition the output of all these inputs in superposition. So such that, I mean, actually I should also say that this unitary operator is efficient if I can find an efficient way to, let's say, to decompose it into elementary quantum gates, right? In this case, there is a quantum circuit that it acts on four qubits, the time and the order operation flow from left to right, and these black things are quantum gates. If the number of gates is a polynomial with the system size, right, means that these things is efficient such that I can compute this unitary operator. And this unitary operator will give me the superposition of output. So I start with the superposition of input, I end up with the superposition of output. So it is a new quantum state. So there is a large advantage because with only one circuit I can process 2 to the power n inputs. The problem is that quantum mechanics is not stopping on the preparation of the wave function. It needs also to have a measurement process, right? So for instance, in this case, as soon as I touch my wave function, it will collapse. So at the end, I will get one classical bit string with a probability which is given by the output weights, right? In this case, gamma square. So there is always, in writing a quantum algorithm, there's always this tension between the huge possibility of processing an exponentially large number of inputs and the fact that at the end I need to find only, I have to measure and get only one string about all the possible outputs. And to be concrete, one possible unitary operator, which is also very important in physics, is the Hamiltonian simulation operator. So e to the power aigt, where h is a local physical quantum Hamiltonian, for instance, the Ising model, which is also used in the rest. This is why I feature in these slides. So this is more or less the idea. So a quantum computer is a machine that should operate at the wave function level and manipulate this wave function in order to get a useful quantum computation, actually a usable computation. So in the last slide, I just wanted to show a little bit what is the progress of today. So today we have many vendors and companies that may provide you with the order of 100 qubits hardware, but these hardware are noisy. In a sense, the unitary here that I'm going that I want is not exactly the unitary that is going to be performing the computer because there are quantum error and hardware error. But the way forward, as much as we have a fault tolerant classical computer, is to have million of qubit quantum computer which are fault tolerant, so without error. The price to pay is that there's going to be very slow, or at least much slower, because we have to perform these quantum gates in a fault tolerant way. So this means that even if you have a quantum algorithm which has a scaling advantage for runtime, you start with a huge offset, right? Such that the threshold for quantum advantage, which is the minimal system size for which the quantum computer is faster compared to the classical, may be very well delayed. So the overall business of practical quantum advantage is just to find what is the best the best algorithm and application for which we will see quantum advantage as faster as we can. So as faster in the future, right? So for which the system size n will be smaller. And I claim in this talk that sampling may be one of these applications just because it fulfills some properties that we are going to see, which are really useful for. So quantum mechanics with these measurement collapses are really made of for sampling, right? And I'm going to show you this. But first, let's go to the now on the other side, which is the application. So I guess that many of you are familiar with the problem of sampling from a complex energy landscape. So for instance, in discrete model, spin glass is the prototypical complex system, which embodies a lot of complexity of much more specialized system like proton folding or single processes or optimization. But it's very clean, right? So people specify in spin glass because they're very, very, the Hamiltonian is simple, but it is very hard anyway, right? So classically, what can you do to simulate a spin glass? And by simulation, I mean evaluating statistical mechanics on this Hamiltonian. So you use the Metropolis algorithm, basically, and that, for the people that are not very familiar, it works like that. So you suppose that you have a two-dimensional array of spins, and white means spin down, for instance. So you start with the all spin down, then you randomly select one spin, and you propose to flip the spin. So by proposing, just say, I pick this spin randomly. Then I have to accept whether this move is going to be performed or not. And to do so, you just need to check the energy difference with respect to the neighbor that my proposal will make, right? So therefore, I accept the trial configuration, this new update with a probability, which is the minimum between one and the Boltzmann weight, which is the change in energy that we will make if I flip. Suppose that I flip in this case because there are some thermal fluctuation, even if I will flip the spin against all the other. I flip the spin, this is my new configuration, then I go on, I can try to select this, and then maybe this time is not accepted, I repeat, and now this time is accepted, and so forth. So it's clear that many Metropolis steps are needed to generate a truly uncorrelated configuration. And by truly uncorrelated configuration, I mean it is different, right? So you can really see visually that is a different picture, right? Of course, there is more rigorous method to define, but I mean, for this purpose, is enough to look at this configuration. So there are two tricks to speed up the Metropolis. One is to literally make each update faster using a special purpose machine. For instance, Parisi put forward this FPGA machine that performs one update of H2 picosecond. Another, which is more elegant in my opinion, is to perform really a new in-one updates generate a very uncorrelated configuration, such that I only need one Metropolis update to generate different and uncorrelated configuration, which are distributed according to the Boltzmann weight. So this is the challenge. The fact that in general, we cannot engineer this type of moves. So here is where quantum mechanics comes into play, in my opinion, because we have to realize that wave function collapses, which are a problem in normal quantum computing algorithm, may also be an advantage because they are uncorrelated. So suppose that in continuous space, I prepare a wave function which is bimodal, and then I keep collapsing the wave function. These collapses are uncorrelated. So if I collapse on the left of the well, then the next collapse is still 50-50, right? There is no memory in quantum mechanics. So the basic idea would be that, okay, let's prepare a wave function such that its modulo square is exactly the Boltzmann distribution that I want to sample from, right? In other ways, let's prepare a wave function psi, which is the square root of the rho, which is my target. So it is conceptually possible to optimize a suitable parent Hamiltonian in order to get this ground state. And this is the Fokker-Planck operator, which is for your information given here. So it requires some Laplacian and the gradient of the real physical potential. And the square root of the Boltzmann distribution is exactly the eigen state with eigen value zero. Unfortunately, this is impractical because the spectrum of the Fokker-Planck operator is very peculiar. So the ground state is zero, but there is a first excited state, which is a vanishingly close in energy from the ground state. So at the first, you will say, okay, in principle, it's possible, but I will never be able to optimize a wave function with a vanishing gap. Now, instead of despair, we can try to look of this first excited state is on a spatially graph, right? On a spatial plot. And then you realize that, okay, the first excited state is not the square root of the Boltzmann, but it's not really bad, right? Because if I take the modulus square of this guy, is still usefully localized on the two wells. So if I sample from it, I will still get a sample 50% of the time on the left, on 50% of the time on the right. And in this paper that I put here in the bottom right, there is a very nice elegant theory of statistical mechanics formulated using this Fokker-Planck superoperator, which tells you that if there is a physical potential V with K local minima, the spectrum of the Fokker-Planck operator has a K low energy eigenstate separated by a large gap. Such that the idea is that if we are able to keep preparing this state in this low line sector of this operator, or we can keep constrained the dynamics in this subspace, then we keep, if when we measure, keep generating samples which are usefully localized where we want to sample, right, in these wells. The problem is that only the real ground state is going to be the square root of the Boltzmann. The other will be different, right? So if I sample exactly from the third excited state, I'm not going to sample for the Boltzmann. So in this case, we have to see this procedure not as the full procedure, but just as a proposal for a metropolis. So again, suppose that I want to sample from the blue distribution, but I can only prepare the red or a collection of red curves, which are these eigenstates. Then I can still sample from the red, but then I will perform subsequently an acceptance step as in the metropolis. And this is done classically, right? So the sequence of this quantum state preparation measurement and the classical acceptance define a valid Markov chain, which is pretty cool in my opinion. The thing is that continuous space models are not really hardware friendly, right? Because the qubits are discrete degrees of freedom. So in order to show this in hardware, we have to specify with a different type of problem, which are discrete models, which are these spin glasses that I told you at the beginning, right? In this case, there are not really a Laplacian of a potential, right? Because the energy is like that. So we cannot construct the Fokker-Planck operator. So we need to be a little bit more heuristic and just add a quantum fluctuation term. So this is going to be my quantum Hamiltonian, which will substitute the Fokker-Planck quantum Hamiltonian of before. And the procedure is again closer to the metropolis. So I start with a string state, so a classical state, which I call psi zero, but it is just one string among all the possible one in the basis state in the Hilbert space. Then I perform my quantum proposal, which is the real-time evolution of this Hamiltonian for a time t. After the time t, I will get a superposition of candidate update configuration. So I will get a real wave function, right? In this perspective, I have a possible candidate configuration, right? And then I measure. This measurement, again, makes the process to collapse only in one of them. This is my proposal. And on this proposal, I will perform my final metropolis acceptance step. In this first paper, I arrived up to more or less here, so also using spin Hamiltonian. The things that were missing is that I could prove that this proposal is also symmetric. And this proposal is in this quantum update is indeed symmetric, so it greatly simplifies the metropolis algorithm such that becomes really trivial to perform this. So in our next paper, we formalize this theory. And we specified on spin model and perform the proper size scaling. Indeed, the fact that a Markov chain is a Markov chain doesn't mean automatically, even if I use a quantum computer, that is going to be better. So it's for sure is more fancy, right, to use a quantum computer to sample from a classical Boltzmann, but we have to prove still that it's more efficient. And indeed, we in this paper with my former colleagues at IBM, we did this. So we use a Sheraton-Kirpatrick model, and we monitor the correlation time as the size increases, as the temperature is decreased. So since the system is very small, we can fill all the full transition probability matrix in this graph. diagonalize the matrix, find out the gap, which is the inverse of the correlation time. So the bigger the gap delta, the better is the Markov chain. And we see indeed that the quantum mediated proposal, the indirect curve, is outperforming always the local updates, which is the best thing that you can do in this mode. Is only worse than a stupid uniform proposal at high temperature, but at high temperature we know that every configuration becomes equiprobable, so it's okay to sample uniformly random from one of them. So we didn't expect that this is going to be better at all temperature, but in the relevant low temperature window it is. And most important, there is also a size scaling. Because if we, although this is a very small size scaling, up to 10 objects, 10 particles, we see that the gap decreases more slowly for the quantum update compared to the other ones. Actually, there is almost a factor 3.6, so like a quartic speed up in scaling. So if we do a back of envelope calculation and we quote the number of Parisi FPGA, we see that machine for it is very is pretty large, is a 80 by 80 by 80 lattice, it can simulate, perform 10 to the power 18 local updates each month. So quartic speedup means that I only need 10 to the power 4.5 updates to get the same quality of the samples, of the sampling. So I need to perform 10 to the power 4.5 quantum update each month. This means that more than one quantum update each minute, which is something reasonable, taking account that these things requires to keep talking with the quantum computer in the cloud, getting initialize the circuit, do the measurement, take back the result and iterate this. So it is feasible, at least. So there is no clear order of magnitude mismatch between what we want and what we can do. And speaking about real hardware, the team at IBM really implemented the algorithm on a quantum machine, and we see that the real experiment value of the gap is close to the theory one. It is actually between the theory and the uniform proposal, and this makes perfect sense because the noise that on current hardware can only shift this idea toward a more uniform type of scheme. So in conclusion, there is this, we have put forward this new algorithm for sampling that we can call quantum power sampling, which is a new candidate for algorithm for quantum advantage that together with other and much more popular and famous algorithm comes with guarantees on the answer, because at the end, given that there is the acceptance step, I will always sample from the Boltzmann, even if I have noise. The noise, what gives me? It gives me that I reduce my efficiency compared to the best possible theory proposal, right? So the noise only decrease the efficiency, but do not gives me the a wrong distribution, which is important. But it's also an algorithm that is feasible, so it can also be performed on noisy machine, therefore it can be performed likely before the fault-tolerant computer will appear in some maybe 5 years, 10 years, I cannot say. So in conclusion, we propose this method with use a quantum circuit as a sampler for classical model, and the quantum speedup can be rationalized the fact that we query the energy landscape in superposition. And now the wave function collapses are not a problem, actually is the reason why this algorithm should perform better. And because it generates updates which are close in energy of the model, but are very far away in Hamming distance. And we are able to demonstrate in simulation in hardware that seems to be a qubit and quartic speedup with respect to the best classical update of the Metropolis for ISI model. And thank you for your attention, and I hope that I stayed marginal in time.